slept like 3 days. I don't know how to say any time.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think that it is dependent on where the Okay, what are the, some of the new deductions you put in, like the itemized deduction and some of that? Can you explain that?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It is the mortgage, property tax, and medical deductions. And also, well, those are the deductions that are put in, again, starting at 50% in 2018, 75% in 2019, and 100% in 2020.
Okay. On the profile that was handed out in TOPEKA, did you take into account for the federal tax bill that could happen this year? My understanding is there's probably going to be on the child care credit, the new administration proposing the expense at 100%. So taking that from 25% to 100%. So if we add this new child care language in, the possibility that it could be a bigger number. Did you calculate this good note on that?
Senator Floyd.
Thank you. It would actually be a question for the gentleman that handed out the flyer. That is not my handout.
Okay. Did you take that into account, that there could be a higher fiscal load if the federal tax credit of daycare or child care deduction goes from 25% on the high to 100%? And we are going on the federal government, it's going to cost more money. Did you take that into consideration?
Senator, would you like to address that? Would you like to?
Thank you. In this form, thank you.
The profile that you are in possession of is built on what is current law today and changes to Kansas law. It does not take into account any speculation on the future federal law.
How about the earned income credit? Did you guys have any knowledge that it might be going to
happen?
Thank you. That was not discussed in committee, and the EITC was not touched. It remains at 17% for Kansas, refundable.
Senator Johnson.
Thank you. Well, the federal tax credit goes up. The earned income tax credit, would it cost the state of Kansas more money?
Senator Floyd.
Thank you. That is correct.
Okay, because that's one of the things you're talking about nationally. That seems like a pretty bipartisan solution to probably have. You know, early in the year, one of the things I got was our exemptions. Let me tell you something. In 2017, our exemptions are $6,750,000,000 and some change. And if we get nothing, guess how much they are? Nothing. In 2018, they go up $253 million and we did nothing. I think part of the problem here is we didn't really look at this comprehensively.
Yeah, send it to email.
We didn't look at the growth program. You know, we got where Larry Capers, which I didn't vote for, $100 million. I didn't vote for the $1 billion bond deal. All we're doing there is we're putting debt on our kids. We're re-amortizing Capers because we won't make tough decisions in this body. Earlier this year, I brought an amendment to take elected officials out of Capers. I introduced that bill already. Next year, I'm also going to bring a bill capping the state contribution to CAPERS when it hits a certain target to try to take care of our teachers and protect CAPERS for the future. Because what's going to happen is we've got too many people that are benefiting that have high salaries and that are getting very large pensions. And the taxpayer, I don't believe aim for us to do that. I believe that it came for us to take care of our teachers. teachers, the people that are most vulnerable in our state. So I'm interested about that. We're going to have a lot of tax debate next year because we're going to have to re-amortize papers, and they'll probably be back for another tax increase. You know, another thing is, I heard yesterday, or maybe a couple days ago, all the days we run together, about the conditions of our roads. And do we have the best, or do we have the fourth best? You know, I have to believe if we have the best in the country, which is great, that means we're probably resurfacing them roads or redoing them all the time, and maybe sometimes unnecessarily. You know, my dad grew up in southeast Kansas, and there was a road that was put in concrete in 1955. And I drove down that road many times from the 9 miles area there, 10 miles to the new corner. And about 5 years ago, they finally resurfaced it. They got the full life out of it. I think sometimes we focus on what we spent. We spent about $1.2, $1.3 billion in Johns County in the last 10 years on roads. They made the intersections really nice and easy to travel. But it's also been pretty hectic up there to travel around the road construction. You know, as I've been here 13 years, I've watched, I won't say our current chairman, but I've watched other chairmen get plenty of new roads and bridges out in rural areas of this state that probably weren't needed. You know, we're in a damn turn in the economy that's been flat for over 10 years. And yet, we're going to sit here and we're going to take more of Kansas taxpayers' revenue. I'm deeply upset with what we're doing here. We're getting into their purse, their treasure. I mean, we haven't even thought about what $600 million is going to do to the economy when it disappears next year. It's going to disappear. You think the tax revenue is going to be up? I mean, what's that? I'd like to know what it's going to take to just get the $600 million back. I mean, you're going to have somewhere between 7.5% and 10% growth. We don't have that in this state. We've talked about every tax. We've talked about utility tax. I mean, gosh, if you're a business, why would you want to come to Kansas to invest? I would be scared off. You know, we run the budget bill the other night, and, you know, I've been here a long time, and I've seen a lot of stuff put in a budget. It seems like this year we did most of it pre-coming to the floor. It's just like this tax bill or the education bill. I wonder what was handed out behind the scenes to get people's vote. I'm sure a lot was. You know, it's sad to me that that's the way it works in this bill. I watched legislators, senators, and House members get four-lane highways that they don't need and cost the taxpayers millions of dollars and call it progress. I believe we need to do a better job. I don't think this tax policy that we're passing today is going to fix the problem. We're going to be back here in the next year or two to add more money and more money. This is the start. This isn't the end. This doesn't fix it. I mean, the LLC, some people call it the tax or the loophole, pass through. What's going to happen when all the companies start paying taxes next year? I tell you what's going to happen. I talked to a lot of businesses in my district. They're going to lay people off because they can't afford them. And then what happens? We'll have higher unemployment. I'll tell you what, I know we're going to be back here dealing with capers, something that we keep borrowing from, stealing from, layering from, and then we're pushing the debt off to our kids. because we can't manage our finances in this building. I'll tell you, I need to be a taxpayer in Kansas tomorrow, because they're going to get an eye-opening that their taxes are going to go way up, and this is not what people told them last November. They said they were going to repeal the LLC loophole. They didn't tell them they're going to increase their taxes. I'm sure they're going to be excited when that happens. I just don't know how anybody can support this, but I'm sure there'll be 21 or plus. But as we got a flat economy that's not growing, you're going to see a lot of trouble for paying the taxes from the people at the bottom that don't have an extra money that you just taxed them. That have to decide whether if you're going to eat gas, which gas is always high, it seems like. And I'm surprised we didn't figure out a gas tax. We seem to hit everything else. Or if you pay their taxes. But I know good Kansans, they'll struggle to pay them, meet their obligations, spend a little less time with their family so they can watch and play baseball or the struggles of life. I urge the body to support this conference report.
Senator Fulton, do you wish to respond?
I do. I would just like to comment. It was mentioned that the economy is flat. Well, I think if we would talk to the ag and oil industry in Kansas and air industry, they would have another word for it, and it is not flat.
Additional comments or questions on Senate Bill 30? Chair recognizes Senator from Douglas, Senator Francisco.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I do have a question for the Senator from London. She will stand for it.
She will.
Will the tax committee be meeting next year, and if changes are made to the federal tax structure, will we have an opportunity to address those?
Senator from London.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. That's a difficult question. We worked hard with the tax committee this year. We were in the process of putting a bill together, and you know, I would like to think that we would, but we'll see what next year brings.
Senator from Douglas.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. I do appreciate that honest answer. None of us know, but I believe if there are changes in the federal regulations about deductions, we will have that opportunity to address them. I also recognize that we are restoring some of the taxes, but in all cases, the rates will be lower than they have been in tax year 2012. And also that this money will be spent in the Kansas economy. This is going to be investments we're making, unfortunately, perhaps not as many as we'd like in our roads or our state water plan, but this money will be spent. Much of it in Kansas, and hopefully we will see a return on that investment and some increases in the activity and business in this state. I'm in support of this bill.
Additional comments or questions on Senate Bill 30? Senator from Butler, Senator Masters.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Kind of looks like we're crossing sometimes, and I got a big, big, big truck. You like playing bringing in a dead horse in that. $1.225 billion increase in our budget. you know, we come up here to represent our constituents. And I know that if you're fully here, you hear from people say, well, you're not representing me, because they might have a minority position in the thought. You can't, I understand, we can't represent everybody in actuality, because people have different mindsets on different subject matters. But we can certainly represent the majority. And each district is a little different. So I get that too. So each of us, sometimes we're a little colloquial in how we cast votes on issues. There are issues outside of morality, life, things like that. Here we have taxes. Those polls we've been talking about, I mean, they're accurate because you have them on both sides of the ideological fence confirming the same information. Our people thought they thought when we hit those doors last year that you were coming up here, those were even for the tax piece. Thought you were closing the loophole. They think you were doing 24% increases on wages. It is strikingly ironic to me that we had this debate yesterday on the budget, where we're running these little tricky men that's trying to say we don't take money away from them. $9 an hour front line service worker. So we want to put that little raise in the budget. If you're turning around today, take it away. Okay. You raise taxes on people. That's what we're doing. Because we want to make government spending decisions easier. The math works in the alternative. Look at this thing. We're increasing spending so much, along with a $0.2 billion tax increase, you run a negative at the end of 24 months. 24 months. Sucking $1.2 billion out of our economy. In that same 24 months. I don't know how you expect to find growth in that. Here I go, banging the drum, beating the dead horse. We are increasing our spending by tens of millions of dollars, unnecessarily, so we can retroactively impose hundreds of millions in tax increases on a people that tell us 75% they want us to go a different direction. And it's striking me too that some seem to be almost giddy. That somehow this is a win. Right? This is somehow an accomplishment, a victory, if you will. This is a legislative victory. To impose this much tax on the people that in the, when Kansas spoke, said not this. So Mr. Chairman, clearly, I'm going to vote no.
Additional comments or questions on Senate Bill 30? Chair recognizes the Senator from Brown, Senator Powell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I have a question for the Congress Committee Chair.
Please proceed.
Can you tell me what guarantee we have that the numbers on the spreadsheet before us are going to actually come into effect?
Senator from Lowe.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. That was not my spreadsheet.
Senator from Lowe.
The carrier, whoever put up the spreadsheet, did somebody answer a question for you, Mr. Chair?
The chair will attend to, as with all profiles, the legislative research department and the legislative advisors put that spreadsheet together using the best estimates that they could.
Very good.
Yes.
Always estimates. Never actual. Never limited what we've actually been taking in, building off of that gross rate or whatever it is. It's always estimates, crystal balls. trying to determine what we can spend in this building, how much, how far can we go. It's no different. I was just thinking through, I was asked earlier if I was being prepared. I don't know. I don't really. I just have a lot of thoughts that are coming together, kind of. But I'm going to look back a little bit. We've heard, I had handouts, Ann Wonderman today, or maybe it was yesterday, I can't, but budget cuts and look back. And then if you take and pull the numbers from research, revenue, increase, and yet the rhetoric is cut. Cuts because we're talking about estimates, projections, here's where we want to go. Every time we get these estimates and projections of where you want to go, you flatten out of gas. Because you haven't figured out how many miles you're going to get to the gallon. Because you haven't looked when you fill up the tank at the odometer to see and adjust and figure out how many miles a gallon your car gets. Well, let me just explain a little bit of my thoughts. I was here in 2002 in the House tax increase. Governor Graves here, Hubble's here, saying he wouldn't sign a budget basically until a tax increase was passed. I'm not sure if the members who were here then voted for that tax increase or not. We could look just a few around. We made history that year. That was the longest session in history at the time. Tax increase. Because revenues weren't going to be good enough. We got to get them. 2010, we've been talking, I heard a lot of about structural fixes. Boom, my mind. Structural fixes. Well, what do you call it? You pass a budget, and everybody can really do what's going to work. And then the governor makes a law, it's governor departments that made laws to that budget. What was the structure right then? Oh, it wasn't a structural fix. It wasn't a structural problem. It was. I mean, come on. That's the rhetoric that's going around right now. It's all structural. Well, the 2010 tax increase was a 3-year sales tax. It was supposed to come back down. Did it? No, because the spending kept going up. We can't go back to lower rate. Oh my. Numbers won't work. Our estimates will be off. Projections will be wrong. We gotta have more revenue. Gotta have more revenue. 2010. More revenue. So it all got permanent. Make permanent. Then we jump ahead. 2012. Governor signs a $700 million tax cap. Some members on this floor admitted that I was one of them. Some admitted it with the intent to kill him. Amendments were put on for the purpose that he'll never sign this, but you know what he did? Some of you didn't think he would, but amendments on that actually were responsible for some of those cuts, because we're quite serious enough to realize that the governor would sign that bill. $700 million tax cut. And we heard nothing but angst against it by the left. Well, you know what happened in 2013 under this leadership of the President of the Senate? We had a bill that was billed as a tax reform to that tax cut, which actually raised $350 million. It was a positive revenue again. So I call 2013 a tax increase because it was. It took back half of the tax cut. In a different fashion. It was a tweaking of the tax laws to make what somebody else wanted, the way they wanted to design. It was a tax increase, nevertheless. 2013, tax increase. Well, what happened? It was the work. 2015, not enough revenue. Estimates are off. We're in the hole. Come on, man. We got to have another tax increase. That tax increase was a little over $400 million. Those numbers weren't accurate. There's your $700 million. Okay, $350 and then $400. That's $750. So you just canceled out the tax cuts in 2012. here we are, 2 years later, 2017. Probably. Yes, thanks, Cindy. We're stuck on the side of the road. Gotta have a major tax increase to fix this. Largest tax increase in history. The largest. You know how much large? We're going from 400 to 600. And you know what? This spreadsheet still says you're going to have problems in 4 years. So the habit, 2010, 2002, 2010, 2013, 2015, 2017. Wow. Free tax increases in the city in the last few years. And yeah, people say we don't have a spending problem, we have a revenue problem. Yeah, that one isn't a revenue problem because you want to spend as much as you want to spend. Big side. You know, it hidden within this one is something that's going to be. There's a tax cut within this bill. Those that want to carry losses forward are going to fix that LLC problem so that they can't carry the losses forward and actually have to be able to reduce their tax dollars. One of my wife's favorite movies, and I don't know for sure whether it's her favorite because she can map through it or not, but it's called The Ten Commandments, as Charles Heston. And that is an interesting movie from a standpoint that it's based upon some biblical information. And I find it interesting because once in a while I like to read the Bible. I like to look at that book. And ever since I've gotten into the political arena, I find the politics of that book very, very interesting. But in that movie, Charles Heston portrays Moses. And his people are enslaved to the Egyptians. And there's a boss guy named Pharaoh. And Pharaoh has his taskmasters, which Moses eventually, you know, he's drunk through the bed, out there to the taskmasters, beating somebody up because he's not stomping enough to make enough bricks for Pharaoh. And Pharaoh commanded, it says in Exodus 5, but Pharaoh commanded the same day the taskmasters. People and their officers say, you will shall no more give the people straw to make bricks. Let them get up the straw for themselves. But he goes on, he says, the tally of bricks which they did make shall not diminish. Kind of what Taskmaster Terry Meyer said. We want $600 million more in your dollars next year. And you know what? We want you to work a little harder. I think that's perfect. We want you to go out and work a little harder. You know what? People in here that are voting for this are telling the taxpayers. They're telling the families. Return hard, tell the hardworking people in Kansas, you're going to work exactly as hard as you've been working. No more free time. You keep working, and the tally of bricks shall not diminish. In fact, we want more. You're going to go gather some straw to make those bricks. You're going to make the same amount of bricks. We're going to profit off of you. And oh, the roundhouse. Nice paved roads. Beautiful bricks out there when you look out the window. Drive around Kansas, come up in my district. See how many brick paved driveways you have. How many businesses, because of this burden, you're not going to have people. But you told them, tally of bricks shall not diminish. You got to make it work. Make the reductions to your family budget, your household budget. But by God, you're going to make it work because it won't worry your money. State of Kansas can't spend fast enough, it seems. Work another day, work another hour, find a part-time job. You know, all the time, the families out there, their costs are going up. Music lessons, the other things that they want to do. Everything increases for them every year. They have cost of living increases too. So we're telling them, keep making those bricks. Don't stop. Keep working. Make your paycheck go a little further for the state of Kansas. It says in here, it says, let there more work be laid upon the men. And the taskmasters, the people went out, and they spake and said, thus said Pharaoh.
Oh, did I say the Pharaoh?
They were the taskmasters, we're the legislature. We're here because someone has said, we've got to have a lot more funding. We're not satisfied or content with what we have. We want more. Let the people of Kansas that are out there working, earning those dollars, be the ones that are content. Let them make more bricks. Let them make it and go get their own straw. I think it's an appropriate story for what we're doing here tonight. What's going on in this legislature? Estimates and projections. You know, if we want real structural change, we start building budgets off of past roads. We take 3 years, 4 years, whatever, average it out, and say that, you know, there's what we're at. That's the top. We know we're not going to have any more than that. So let's at least stay within those confines. But if you want to go far enough back, you can look at 9% growth when the revenue was good. People were working hard. Revenue grew. Economy was good. That's not the case today. I don't think anyone could say that the economy is just booming right now. And we don't want it to grow. I'm glad there's not a lot of people out there that can talk. You know, maybe a lot of people are through this thing. I got a book in my desk. I can read. You want to read Prince? You want to read Old Mock Valley? You want to read Mein Kampf? You want to read little Marx? Maybe that's what some of you do. You read about the fireplace. They had a design, they think about how society should work. Kind of goes with building, the way the Pharaoh wants to build. They're going to make us all his slaves, and we're just here serving his taskmasters every day, trying to make merch about straw. Being glad, you think it's fun. Go out and see the people in the country, go out and see the people in the city. People that get up there every morning go to work 8 to 5. Come home at night. Try to pay their mortgage. Pay their hospitals. I got a daughter and a pretty baby. They're still paying hospital bills. And you're going to ask them to pay more. And you're doing it really rapidly. Wow. Then, maybe we ought to reduce some retroactive business and go back and reduce the taxes that we put on. Maybe that would get our economy going. Never thought of that. Maybe if we reduce taxes, let people have more. Maybe they would be able to spend it and boost the economy. Businesses would do better. And more productivity. That's a knowledge that work around here. I think Pharaoh said, so let it be written, so let it be done. It's not going to be on this tax bill. That's what you're going to be saying. Tally works shall not be reduced, shall not be reduced. Keep working. Keep ascending in your work. Stay in Kansas once again. So the people were scattered abroad to gather stubble instead of straw. Taskmaster case and saying, fulfill your works, your daily task, as when the rest goes wrong. Mayor Hospital bills. Pay your utilities. Pay everything that you're paying today. Make it work, taxpayers. Make it work. But we're taking safety as a table one. Incomes go down. Money they have to spend. I used the illustration last time when I spent a $100 bill. They have pretty much illustrated what we're asking, what the state's asking. You know, I wondered today what I would say if this were getting past the House and be here before us tonight. I think I'll say exactly what Moses would say. Let my people go. How much is enough? 2010, 2013, 2015, 2017. A habit needs to be broken. Spending is the problem. And until we realize that there needs to be some contentment in government, it's going to keep going. And as we stated earlier on this floor, the profile shows you're going to be right back here. Like Seatmate said it too. We've seen it's right there. It's on this profile. You run out of money to meet your habit. Now, interesting though, bad habits are bad habits. They're hard to break. I've spoken long enough, I know that. But I just, the history, what I've seen the past 3+ terms here in the Senate, especially the past 4 years, what I've seen in the tax and spend that's going on in this building, I just shake my head. People are in a mood. I don't think they won't. There are 10 states in this nation that don't have income tax. They're going to give it some action, I think. So, anyway, if you haven't seen the Ten Commandments, it's a good movie. It's about 6 hours long. I think my wife likes it because I do think she likes to nap. She's seen it enough times. She knows what's going to happen when she wants to take a nap. But it is interesting, then, too, if you read the actual account of the book of Exodus in the Bible, to actually see what the story is. And you are the taskmasters. Masters were here. And the taskmasters were going to make a decision tonight. And I believe folks were there. I have no doubt that folks were there to do this. I know if I do believe it's going to pass. Question is how high will the numbers be? So, Mr. Chairman, I'm going to oppose this bill, and I think I've stated obviously the reasons why, but I do hope everyone in this body realizes there is a bad habit and it needs to be addressed. And if you think you're fixing a structural problem, a structural part of the budget, you're wrong. And you'll find that out in a couple of years. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Additional comments or questions on Senate Bill 30? Chair recognizes the Senator from Saline, Senator Harding.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. I felt compelled to get up because a year ago May, I was watching a forum in Salina. With the candidates that were running for office, and my senator on his way out the door said to the crowd, "We just have a spending problem." I said to myself at that point, he does not get it. I was in the highway industry for 35 years, and since 2010, the legislature has robbed
$2.7 billion with a B from the highway fund. That, in my mind, could not continue. So I said to myself, you know what? I'm a lowly city commissioner. I don't know if I can win, but I have to try. So I drove down to Topeka, paid my filing fee, and started running for office. And little did I know how big a bite I was taking off when I was selected to run for a Senate district. But I did. I knocked on 4,000 doors during that campaign process. And my message was, we need to repeal the 2012 tax policy. And I did not find one door that said, you know what? We just have a spending problem. They all agreed with me on this one issue. Where there are other issues that we disagree, but on this one issue, they recognized that we indeed had a spending problem. We had a spending problem. And that encouraged me to keep going, to knock on more doors. And it came time for the primary, and I was successful. And there were several other senators across the state that also thought we had a spending problem. And where are those senators today? Senator Melcher? He's gone. Senator Smith? He's gone. Senator Arkey? He's gone. Senator Knox? He's gone. Senator Bruce?
Senator?
Yes, sir.
Senate rules do not allow you to name out individual senators.
I'm sorry, Mr. Vice President. There are six senators that did not survive the primary. And these six senators all believe that we have a spending problem. I think that primary was the true poll that determined where the people of Kansas wanted to go. The people of Kansas, by voting the way they did in the primary, said to me that they are tired of stealing funds from the highway fund. They are tired of finding one-time money fixes to patch our budget. They are tired of not providing our state employees with raises for over a decade. They are tired of seeing our judiciary employees, 30% of them, having to have a second job to pay their bills. The people of Kansas, in my mind, are willing to pay for the services that they value. Education, highways, taking care of people less fortunate than we are. And I believe that that is what we are here to do. When I ran on total repeal, I'm getting about half of it with this bill. And I think that's a good start. I really do. I think that we're going to stop the hemorrhaging with this bill. We're going to be in a better place this time next year. And as a result of that, I'm going to support this bill.
Additional comments or questions on Senate Bill 30? Chair recognizes Senator Johnson, Senator Lynn.
Thank you. I'm going to get a modest perspective on what the Senator from Saline has outlined, because I just got an email from a constituent who I've never heard from before, and evidently he's a little plugged in. Maybe he's talking to his friends, maybe he's reading blogs, whatever. Somehow he has come to the conclusion, and he wrote me an email. And I'm gonna read it to you, because it's quite in contrast to what we just heard. Why don't you and other legislators try lowering taxes and cutting programs and try cutting the salaries of people that run the universities? Why are there people at the universities making $100,000 a year and more? You need to learn that you're not spending your money. You're spending the money you are stealing from the citizens of the state of Kansas. When I get laid off from work, I can't raise money by stealing money from others. I can go to jail. Why don't you learn how to cut programs from people and learn how to spend within your means? The rest of the people in the state of Kansas have to. So that's just a different perspective from a constituent in my district. And I do stand up and I do support those taxpayers. And obviously he thinks we have some sort of a spending problem. I don't think our taxpayers and our constituents are ignorant. And I don't think all of them buy what goes on in the media fracas that we see in today's political environment. And I, for one, stand up for those people. Because that's what I'm here to do. I'm going to represent them. So I just wanted to share that. I did reply to him. And I thanked him for letting me know. And that his opinion matters. So let's not forget who we all represent and where we get our taxpayer dollars from. Let's just not forget that, because it really isn't about us. Thank you.
Additional comments or questions on Senate Bill 30? Seeing none, Senator?
Yes.
Senator for Cherokee, Senator Tillery.
Thank you, Mr. President. Yeah, I have a question for the carrier.
Please proceed.
I apologize. So kind of new. There's some talk, I think, yesterday about a trailer bill. Do we know if there's a trailer bill coming?
Senator Flynn.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The trailer bill was not necessary. It was previously in the Conference Committee Report, SB 30, and it was dependent on SB 19 passing the House or the Senate, which it did not.
Senator Cherokee.
Thank you. Now I just have a couple of comments, if that's okay.
Please proceed.
I don't know if everybody has had a chance to review these numbers, but minimum wage in the state of Kansas is $7.25 an hour. The same hourly wage, according to our new tax bracket, puts them in the middle of income. Someone making $14.42 now in our new bracket is now a rich person. I kind of disagree with that. I can remember when I was younger and just starting out. That's not a lot of money to make. And that's not a lot of money to support a family and raise a family. After I'm looking at this, I kind of wonder would I violate some type of ethical issue if I went out and bought a lot of stock and wrong meals? Because there's something on a lot of that for these people that are making $7.25 an hour. I hope everybody will look at that and look at these tax brackets and think back at when you were trying to start out, trying to raise your family. It's difficult. And there's a lot of people out there in the state that that's where they're at. But we're going to affect a large amount of our citizens. I meant another comment I was going to, but this was brought up, that someone supports this bill because it will stop robbing the highway fund. I don't know if they didn't review this form that was put out, the calculations are still wrong. The higher that.
Additional comments or questions on Senate Bill 30? Senator from Johnson, Senator Olson for the second and final time.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. There was a lot of comments about robbing the highway fund, but one of the first actions that was taken by the legislature in the rescission bill was to rob the PMIB, I guess they call it a loan, line of credit. How are you going to pay it back? You're going to go ahead and rob the next year, basically $83 million, with no plan to pay it back. Don't have a problem. That's on your record. I didn't vote for that. And as the new senator from Crawford said, you're still going to take the money from Capers. One question from the senator from Lynn. The region's employees, are they still tax-free on their Capers?
Senator from Lynn.
Thank you. Yes.
Senator from Johnson.
So, the wisdom of this tax year, one of the things we made sure, which is about a $20 million fiscal note, the professors that our professors at our universities will not pay taxes on their Capers going in or coming out. How right is that? When our average employee has to pay taxes on their income tax going in, our region professors get this break. That's fair. That's how we do things in this building. Just like the PMIB loan. We're not going to be able to pay that back. Just like Capers. We're going to have to re-amortize that so our kids have to pay for it. You know, the guy that invented these loans, he said this was the last tool in his toolbox. Well, I wish he'd shut it because it's horrible what it's doing to our kids. There's going to be a lot of people move out of this city. Our property taxes are too high. Now our income tax is going back. Why would you want to start a business in Kansas? I'll tell you what, though. In this session, we haven't woke up because our taxpayers every day are getting younger and doing things different than they did 10 years ago, 20 years ago. And our tax policy is asleep. The next generation will pay its taxes and do its business different. Look in the real world. Businesses are changing. Blockbuster's gone. If you're going to keep doing things the same way, a lot of the businesses that we have in Kansas are going to be gone too. There's very few small businesses left in Kansas. We have created an environment that's favorable to them. It's the exact opposite. We have these start bond deals, districts, these abatements that our school districts don't receive their portion. The only people who are paying the bills are the small business and our residential consumers. You know, if we don't wake up, our sales tax revenue is going to keep slipping. Our income tax revenue is going to keep slipping. It's because the next generation has figured it out. They'll buy it online. They'll do it different. I think the senator from Sedgwick yesterday had some pretty good comments. You know, on this Larry and on the PMIB, why would we stretch out over 20 years? Whoever thought that it was horrible. But you're doing nothing different. But still, you have $324 million from Kansas taxpayers, and you have no plan to pay it back. Then you give a $20 million, you keep a $20 million tax break in the statute for these professors like they really need it. Then you make the Kansas taxpayers pony up a bunch of more money. Next year, you'll be doing the same. Going to re-amortize Capers, lengthen the payments out. We'll just stretch that debt out a little longer. Oh, and more money for Capers. Well, we got 20 million in region employees that are not paying a paying their fair share, or a keeper's member. But we're going to leave these people out. These people are not at the bottom. They're at the top. They're causing the problem. We got too much money business in this building. Too many people taking care of themselves. You know, when they come in here, they talk about capers as a legislature, or legislators did. I even heard in the 80s, before a bunch of older representatives and senators retired, they put in a super pension. And then some of the people in the hall said, well, they seen that legislator up here about 3 years later, and he was up there lobbying to take it out because he said it was a bankrupt capers. And he didn't want everybody to get it. It's time to get legislators out of the caper system. We have no business in it. People didn't send us up here to make a career out of this, to get a retirement. They sent us up here to do the best we can for Kansas every day. And yeah, you know what? They want their kids to get a good education. They want good roads. They don't mind paying for them, but they do mind people wasting their money. There's a lot of programs that we waste money. We can't put a school finance formula together that will do the right thing. There's school districts with less than 58 kids in them, or with 58 or 70 kids in them, that shouldn't exist. They should be merged into other districts. But instead, we've decided we need to keep wasting the money to keep them facilities because some legislators out there fighting to make sure we keep that school district open. Fact is, he should be fighting to merge them with another district because we're wasting the taxpayers' money is what we're doing. It's just like in this state, we're going to wake up in about 50 years and realize that we don't have good water resource because in the 80s, we gave too many water rights out to people in Western Kansas. Almost doubled the water rights. I supported the senator from Sherman's bill the other day, and I think it's right. People in Western Kansas ought to see what fishing's like. But the sad thing is that our water policy in this state is in shambles because we got ag, we got larger cities. And we can't get it figured out. We need to be building more reservoirs and get the streams running again so they see what lakes are like in Western Kansas. But what we've done, we've over-appropriated water rights, and there's no water in the creeks or the reservoirs. It doesn't run anymore in the western part of the state. You know, it's time that we put this state first and create a tax policy that's going to work for the next 30 or 40 years, not trying to keep patching an old one. We need to put an education formula together that's going to say it's time to merge school districts together and close the schools that are not efficient. They did it before in the past. Every little city used to have their own school district. And as the cities keep on, they merged with other districts. We're not recreating the wheel. It's time that we put our state first across our state. And I'll tell you, having 58 kids in the school district, which I'm going to find out, I'm going to find out how many kids is in each class. Because what if there's only one kid? Well, the teacher to student ratio would be awful low there. But you know, I don't think we care about that. I think we're just going to spend more money. We're going to rob and borrow from the PMIB. We're going to layer papers. We're going to make sure that the region's employees don't have to pay taxes on their capers while someone at the bottom of our pay scale for the state does. Now that makes a lot of sense. I urge the body not support this because it's going to take a lot of money out of our taxpayers' pockets. You know, in 2018, our revenue is going to drop $400 million. Another $120 million by consensus estimates. You know what? I know we're going to be back here next year with another tax bill, and I believe we'll be back the year after that. Because the layering, the borrowing, the robbing from the PMIB that happened this year, not having a serious discussion about the rescission bill, we're going to keep doing it. We're going to keep kicking the can down the road, and our kids will be paying the bill. It'll be a lot of lost opportunity, a lot of potential could have happened. We won't get it right on water. We won't get it right on education. We're supposed to be in control of the purse, not the poor. I heard much better speeches in 05 under Montalieu than I heard this year, that's for sure. Today, I hope we just shut that toolbox. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Additional comments or questions on Senate Bill 30? Chair recognizes the Senator from Sedgwick, Senator Solentrop.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. I'll try to make this brief. I began to share a tax and budget proposal with a number of people throughout this week and the latter part of the prior week. Now I will have copies after we finish here tonight to continue the discussion, hopefully. And to address the Senator from Saline's concerns about having adequate funds to take care of our roads, take care of our pay raises, take care of our schools, it appears to me that in the profile here, we're underwater in 24 months. I have a proposal here, shows an ending balance. In 2020, of $256 million. In 2021, $277 million. You know, the questions and concerns that I've got when I've shared this with people is just like, oh, this is going to be hard to do. We've got a group of lobbyists that want to protect the CIF. I get it, I understand that. But we can take that investment and move it from the tobacco fund over to the tobacco tax to pay for that. It takes care of it. It gives them more stability than the tobacco fund. That should take that reason out for why we're doing it. Let's securitize $19 million. We'll save $154 million. We won't have to retroactively tax taxpayers. And in 24 months, we won't be broke coming back for another increase in taxes. I already voted for a tax increase. I already voted to repeal the small business tax. I'm looking for a logical, common sense approach to go forward. This is not going to be easy to pass either. It's a tax increase. It's a tax increase. Nobody wants to raise taxes. If we're going to do it, let's do it with some common sense. Let's look beyond 24 months. We're elected here for 4 years. Somebody's concerned about, in the House, about getting reelected. They ought to be concerned about getting reelected on a tax bill of $600 million and we're broke in 24 months. Let's at least put the mechanics together to get a solid cash flow and a budget in this year that makes sense so that we can address those areas, so that we can address the roads.
That's a good question.
So we can address the issues going forward. These are just common sense things. Now, I will feel like too late. Enough time. I can assure you, in 48, 72 hours, it'll all be accomplished. And we can be out of here. And we can be on the right path forward. To take care of the concerns that Senator Solis has, and everybody else in this chamber. Whether it's education, pay raises, votes, everything else. Takes a little more fortitude. I'm going to vote against this plan. Hope we'll spend a little time discussing this so we can do this right before we leave. Thank you.
Additional comments or questions on Senate Bill 30? The Senator from Butler, Senator Masterson, for the second and final time.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to move on to you. We had a little incident earlier where professionalism an issue. So I'd like to pose for those whose ideology or thought process says that money was robbed in transportation, right? Even the connotation of criminality, that they sent Steve, who we saw was on all the advertisements in the back of the cafe, and it's quite frankly laughable to think that every door so went knock on that person's one. I want to pose. So if we take a definition there that says that definition of robbery is a legislature by a majority of the signature takes money from a pot that may not have been earmarked for something else that they want to earmark. That would be your definition of robbery from an item. A legislature by a majority of the signature took money from a pot that would have been earmarked here and used it to spend over here. Running out of that definition, look what's present. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, you're about to rob the Kansas people of $3 billion in 5 years. Not 2.7 already. If you subscribe to that line of thought, that line of thought, you are fixing to rob the Kansas people, because you're going to go by majority and take money from a pot, or a pocket maybe better. Now that money wasn't earmarked for us, but we're going to take it. We're going to earmark it somewhere else. It's a problem when you cast this book, Mr. Chairman.
Additional comments or questions on Senate Bill 30? Senator from Brown, Senator Powell for the second and final time.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, I find it interesting that we brought some issues before this body in the last couple of years. Some of the new senators won't want to go with that, but I don't know, this last year before when I tried to figure out why we couldn't define hospitality in the budget. There is no definition, and as far as I know, there still is none. So there's absolutely no way to account for those hospitality dollars, which could include travel, which we had an attempt to try to address some travel issues. But, you know, hospitality, without being defined, is pretty broad. I mean, anything really, it's not defined. So we have no idea how much is being spent on that. That's verified lobby, lots of money. Lots of money, lots of fees, lots of dues, lots of registration, lots of travel. None of that's been addressed. You can't take care of your dollars if you don't take care of your pennies. That's where I was raised. But I thought Mike mentioned, you know, it's interesting. I'm on a farm. Price of grain today, beans are about $8.50 a little below there. Wheat's $3.60. Corn's $3.20. Let's see, I just sold a quarter in January. It needs to be 2 miles for a little over $8,000 an acre. I don't know how he's going to pay for it. And it's a problem. Farm economy right now is not bustling. It's not good. Part of the problem is some of the revenues. But yet, oh boy. We're going to raise it
more with less. You know, it's always interesting to me. I'm not an authority on behavior modification, but we wanted in this body, the state legislature always wants to modify the behavior of the taxpayers. Make them change the way they live. Maybe they can't eat out quite as much as they are doing right now because we need more. We got to spend a little more here. We aren't going to change behavior here. No way. But you're sure going to make the taxpayers change theirs. I can't stop tonight until I ask you to go with me on a little painting. I'm going to try to create a picture in your mind. Imagine right up here in front. I wish I could bring it in here, but I can't. A bathtub. We might as well make it a cloth of it. We'll make it only take 5 minutes so you can really recline and get a good bath. But we want it as big as possible because we want to hold as much water as we can before it starts to run over. But imagine with me, that bathtub up there is full of water. It's full. Uh-oh. It's starting to run over. Oh, you know what this body's going to do? We got to spin this body, spice some towels. Buy more towels. Go buy some buckets. What do we need to do? We need to reach up and turn off the water. And anybody with common sense knows you have to turn off the water to fix a plumbing repair. But not here. You got a spinning problem. You can't turn off the water. You can't say, let's be content. How many people go to work every day that are content right now? You know, they know the likelihood of getting rich is not probable. They're content. They're happy. We have a lot of good people in Kansas. A lot of good hardworking people. They're content. But I think the people of Kansas expect us to know it's time to turn off the water. Not to go spend more money by asking them to pay more. That bathtub is running over. Some of you just want to buy more towels. You just can't stop spending. Oh, make sure they're decorative towels too, by the way. Paper towels will work. But the most absorbent. Buy bigger buckets because that water is going to just run. It's not going to stop. And that's what the problem is here. State of Kansas has a problem. Can't stop spending more and more and more. I think I pointed out earlier the habits that we can see by just looking at what's taking place in the last 10 years. It wasn't always the case, folks. Revenues go up every year. It's very rare if you look at a sheet and ask for the revenue of SGF that it does drop. It does once every great while by a little bit, maybe 0.791%. But it's usually based on something that's happened. But for the most part, revenues go up. Inflation drives them up. The income tax is wrong, like I said. But Mr. Chairman, I couldn't pass up at least speaking one more time. You're all issued. If I can. I'm not an artist, but the bathtub's running over, and it's time to shut off the water. And instead of night, you're going to run out by some high dollar towels and some more buckets. And you're just going to keep trying to fix this problem. I appreciate what the Senator said about the plan that was put before this body. It is logical and it has common sense behind it. But you know what? Shutting off the water is common sense. But it does even go on this body.
Additional comments or questions on Senate Bill 30? Senator Francisco, for the second and final time.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. I did have another question for the Senator from Land Based on some comments that have been made this evening.
I'm just going to pick up something.
Please proceed. Thank you, Mr. Vice President. There was a comment made about the amount of money that was not being paid by members of Regents institutions. I believe this is not to Cambridge, but to the other four paid by. And I think we had some estimates in the tax committee about how much money that would raise. Can the chair of the committee determine that estimate was about $1.7 million, not the $20 million that has been referenced?
Senator from Washington.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. I do not have that number with me, but I think the senator is closer to the number than the other number.
Senator from Douglas.
Thank you, Mr. President. If that's not the case, I hope the research individuals or staff here would help correct me. So I think it is important to know that the magnitude of that, this is not totally was another question for the senator from Lynn. Was a proposal made in tax committee and in fact on the floor in some of the bills we debated to include that in the tax plan?
Senator from Lynn.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. It came up in conference committee today, and if memory serves, we did pass that across the Senate floor at one time.
Senator from Douglas.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. Can I ask the senator from Johnson, who's spoken, if he supported that initiative? When it was in the tax bill?
I believe that's out of order. The questions are directed towards the senator from the.
Thank you. But I surmise that we all had an opportunity to weigh in on that. So, again, we have in front of us a conference committee report, and it's not based on a bill that came out of the tax committee, and it does not include a number of things that the tax committee did have a chance to discuss. One of them was taxes on internet sales. One was trying to be more inclusive with regard to both including businesses and including all members in terms of the pension plans. But that's not what we have before us. We have heard that we do have farmers and ranchers in this state that are not doing well this year. But we also need to remember that this repeal of the LLC will give them an opportunity to be able to deduct their losses. Again, this is not money that we're taking out of the Kansas economy. This is money that we're choosing to spend on behalf of the citizens of Kansas on things like schools, like our roads, like our state water plan, that individually we cannot make those investments. So we're doing it together as a state. We had a long debate about what would be an appropriate budget, and we came to an agreement in this body. Tonight, I believe it's our job to fund that budget, and this option that has been put in front of us is one of the best I've seen so far to be able to do that. I appreciate it being brought before us, and I hear those comments about how we don't want to keep borrowing to avoid that. let's start collecting.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes the Senator from Lane, Senator Tyson.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. It's been brought to my attention that the Regents number of 20-some million could have been in the, and was most probably in the Senate Majority Leader's original tax plan, if he would like to address that.
Any additional comments or questions on Senate Bill 30? Chair recognizes the Senator from Shawnee, Senator Inslee.
Mr. Vice President, last evening I distributed to the Senate a document that's entitled Budget Cuts, A Look Back. And there have been, in the last 8 years, some 16 rounds of budget cuts, starting in the summer of 2008, which obviously would have had to been a block that was made by the governor of Kansas at the time. Governor Sebelius ordered all state agencies to cut 1% from their operating budgets, which amounted to a dollar cut of $14.7 million. And then as you go through this document, you'll see the dates are either allotments that are made by the governor or action that was taken by the Kansas legislature. When Governor Parkinson became governor in November of 2009, this was the sixth round of cuts. They were particularly painful in as much as they totaled almost $260 million, $36 million of which came from K-12 education, $2 million from the Regents, $40 million in reduced highway maintenance funds, reducing the bioscience transfer by $5 million, and a 10% cut to Medicaid, saving approximately $22 million. That included $1.1 from the Meals on Wheels program, $1.2 for in-home services for senior citizens, and so on and so forth. And actually, in between June and November of 2009, there were 850 public employees who were laid off by Governor Parkinson. So this document goes from the summer of 2009 to June of 2016, 16 rounds of budget cuts that amounts to in excess of $2 billion. And of course, that does not include the $2.7 billion that was transferred from the highway fund to the general fund. So in terms of the budget that we have dealt with over time, I think that there have been some responsible decisions made, and I believe that we do have a spending problem. I don't believe we have a spending problem, and these budget cuts bear that out. And at this time, I'd like to yield to the Senator from Douglas.
Senator from Douglas, Senator Hall.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. I rise in support of this tax bill. I want to preface my comments and say this in no way fixes the problem long term. We still have structural problems with this. But it starts to reposition us, putting us back on track. You recall back prior to 2012, we had a philosophy basically of a three-legged stool, where basically to run government, the state, both the state and local levels, we saw a healthy combination of both property taxes, sales and use, and income that we use to run government services in the state. And in 2012, we drank the Kool-Aid and decided we would go down this glide path to zero. If I would equate this to maybe like riding a commercial jet plane, it's been anything but a smooth flight. We've had a heck of a lot of turbulence. And I personally want to get off end isn't taking us anywhere but down the drain. We talk about basically where we're going with this. It doesn't structurally fix the problem long term, we realize that. But the things I like about this is number one is not only does it start to reinstitute our adherence back to the more traditional three-legged tax rule policy that we have, but I also like this plan because it did not go back and take revenue from other non-personal income tax sources. You'll recall back in 2012 when the income tax cuts were put into effect, you look at the tax increases in 13 and the tax increases in 15, they came from other revenue sources. So the folks that were behind the 2012 income tax cuts were more than happy to shift the tax burden, push those additional revenue needs off on those with the smaller voices here in the state government, the ones that don't have lobbyists, and that was okay. What we have done, in a way I think is correct to everybody in this body, regardless of what we said in this issue, is that in trying to get back to the old position, we did not go down the path of continuing consumer taxes and other things. We did not raise cigarette taxes, we did not raise fuel taxes. Because what got us into this mess was cutting off the personal income tax. I like the way this process is going. I can't speak to the process on the budget committee and whatever, but I felt that basically how this tax plan has come to Genesis has been very collaborative. First of all, I want to thank the our tax chair, Senator Tyson. I want to comment her specifically on two things. I was very impressed the way that throughout this entire session, she heard literally every tax bill that was introduced in committee, as far as I was aware. She made an honest attempt to have a hearing. I thought that was wonderful. The second thing that I want to commend her for specifically is that very late in the session, the tax the House sent us over a list of services that they wanted to basically start to tax. We had a very good hearing on that. We brought in people and we started uncovering basically the problems with some of those services being taxed. I thought it was very helpful helping us to arrive to where we are today in this deal. I also want to comment and compliment Senator Lynn from Johnson County. She has talked about this session about we had six periods on star bonds, and it gets back to that old phrase about, you know, we talk about we have a spending problem here. We'll let the public judge that. When we talk about spending, as maybe say, spending occurs on two sides of the ledger. It's on the services where we provide our constituents, and while it's also on the income tax, the other economic, so-called economic incentives that we give as handouts to businesses to grow jobs. So I think it's healthy that we've raised that awareness this session. Specifically, what I like about this tax bill, what's not in it, once again, it does not raise taxes on other sources, because we basically thought that we could get away without running government on income tax, and we cannot. I also like the fact that we have a couple of additional so-called economic development tools that were left by the wayside. The last bit push again, the so-called ad-ass working world jobs tax credit program. There was also an aviation tax credit program that was heard last minute by our committee. And I want to point out to the body that on this, particularly ad-ass, we did not have hearings on that this Senate this year. It was heard in the House. And as so many things are done here at the last minute, the legislative push, the special interest loaded with lobbyists, they come out guns blazing, they try to run stuff down the last minute to get across the finish line. I told our chamber health firm the fact that we need to have a hearing first on that. I want to talk about those programs in particular because, once again, it talks about spending on both sides of the ledger. These are programs, any economic development program is basically taking those tax revenues, in essence, that we have collected from our citizens, and now we're handing them out to other people's money. That's the other insidious side, I think, of government that we don't talk enough about. Because let's face it, that's the special interest side of money. Those are the folks that, you know, buy us the buffets and receptions and all this and that stuff. That's the folks, you know, that are really pushing the agenda behind the scenes. And you can show them Jay Chan's done that cold. We talk about that Ashton Rural Jobs Fund in particular. This is a program where it was introduced in the House. My understanding with this bill is that the proponents of this actually went to the Department of Commerce. They were proactive. They went to Commerce and solicited their input, worked with them to try to craft the bill. And after that work, the Department of Commerce was still neutral on this bill, on the Aviation Tax Credits Program. This was a program brought forward once again by, well, obviously, I'm sure in particular, you know, by a local chamber of an area. No doubt it intended to be well-meaning. They hadn't even reviewed this tax credit with the Department of Commerce. Once again, two programs that are handing out tens of millions of dollars a year, and they're not even being approved by our Secretary of Commerce. They're not evaluated to see how they how they are integrated into the rest of the so-called economic development tools that we offer businesses and other groups to come here to the focus for economic development. So that was, I think, another big thing about this bill is that we didn't layer in additional special interest or just to this thing as we're trying to get help. Because let's face it, a lot of times those things are done to buy votes, not buy votes, but basically get support for things. You might hold their nose because, once again, you know, we get additional interest in it. But once again, using other people's money to fund commerce in this state. I am very happy that we kept off the taxes on services. Once again, as I discussed with that was brought up late in the session. Once again, I want to thank Senator Tyson for having those hearings. I was particularly disturbed about the fact that there, very late in the session, there was this idea brought forward that we're actually going to start taxing computer professional services without really even better understanding what that impact was going to be to tech industries across the state of Kansas. When we talk about taxing services, obviously there's what I'll call point-in-time services, where basically maybe you're getting your nails done, or you're getting a tattoo, or maybe like you're getting your snow removed from your drive. That's a point-in-time tax situation. But we had brought to us late in the session this idea that we're going to start taxing professional services. It could have been IT, it could have been engineering, it could have been architecture, it could have been a number of things. But the basic fact that these things were brought for late in the session, and not even have a general comprehension or appreciation for that, a lot of these services are performed on a long-term contractual basis where agreements have already been entered into, where you have basically vendors and suppliers and competitors outside of the state, outside of the country, that could offer these and basically turn Kansas businesses upside down. That's the type of stuff we pull under this bill. We need to do a much better job of vetting what comes across our floor when it comes to tax policy. And I think that the tax committee has done some good work this year. There's been a lot of talk about how our economy is changing, and, you know, supposedly our tax committee, you know, we haven't done anything. We're not sensitive to these things. Well, I want to point out that the Senator from Johnson Center, and he brought up a proposal basically how we're going to start addressing this hemorrhaging of basically consumer use taxes. Because we are losing those sales across the country. from the Senator Brock Ford, Bills, and the work with the Department of Revenue. We had a hearing on that. We looked at that issue. It's not an easy issue. This isn't easy stuff. You know, yes, our state is transitioning, and yes, our state is stacked. And we have to really start looking at doing some things differently in this state on a longer term basis. But I do think at the end of the day, this is getting us back to that solid three-legged stool tax policy that I think we made a huge mistake here and started to drift away from back in 2012. Once again, obviously this isn't perfect, but this gets us off that disastrous march to zero. I think starts providing stability to our citizens in the forms of services, and I think eventually, in the long term, we'll make Kansas more economically desirable to raise a family and to grow the business. Thank you, Mr. Vice President.
Additional comments or questions on Senate Bill 30? I see none. Senator Lane, you may close.
Mr. Vice President, I yield to the Senator from Ford.
Senator from Ford, Senator Estes.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. A couple of years ago, several Republicans with myself in the House could see things kind of slipping backwards a bit, and we brought forth a proposal to address the LLC small business, so called loophole. And while there were 25 of us actively trying to do that, we didn't get a lot of mileage out of it. The next year we came in again, and the situation was getting more obvious that we needed something that needed to be addressed. And this time there were 32 Republicans, and there was 15 Democrats, we still weren't able to get that done. But the conversation then was, okay, but come this next year, meaning this year, it will definitely have to be addressed. And during the election, it was pretty obvious to almost everybody that that absolutely was going to happen, and I don't care if you're in Eastern Kansas or you're in Western Kansas. That was a topic of conversation. And I know in my legislative forums and campaigns and so forth and so on, but you can talk about that, and the taxpayers talk about it, and they do it. At the same time, I put it out to them, do not expect that to be the only cure, or do not expect that to be the only thing that comes at you. Because I assure you, there's a lot of folks looking at raising income taxes. And while it may be necessary about how much it's going to have to take, I don't know. But there will be those who want to go plumb crazy and go as high as they can, and there will be those that will want to keep it halfway along. It's a little bit hard for them to accept going in, but as time went on, I think everybody pretty much realized that as well. So when we came up here, and we were talking about the possibilities and what we're going to have to do, and on our caucus, and here we were talking about 390 million, something like that. Then you could go up to 450 and put education on it, was somewhere in the 8500. Well, unfortunately, because now we've gone beyond that, and is that absolutely necessary? I know, I guess that's up to the body, that's up to all of us to determine and to vote on. History will tell us in the next decade, I suppose, just how big a either mistake or how right we were. One thing though that really bothers me in conversations and debates that happened in the last week, and especially tonight, conversation when we talk about saving money, I'm a Republican, I'm cutting expenses, you betcha. We know we have to do that sort of thing. But when you start talking about cutting expenses and saving money for the state of Kansas by closing down 100 schools in Western Kansas, or not just the West, but the East as well, that's not exactly what the Republicans, the farmers, and business folks across the state and small towns have in mind. I guarantee you, that little process, those schools are the biggest providers of jobs, of stability for those towns. They're the social center for each community, and then between the communities. So the school systems play a tremendous part in the fabric of our state. Now, I graduated in the 60s when there were schools every 8 miles. That was necessary. Needed to be done, and it was. But now schools are, for the most part, 25, 30, 40 miles apart. So it's not just an easy, quick thing that you're going to save some money by doing this. Transportation is going to go up. But more importantly, the economic loss to those communities, just to save a few bucks for the education system in this state, is not a good trade-off. And while I definitely want us to hold these taxes down, and our taxpayers deserve for us to give that every attention that we possibly can, I also remind you that those taxpayers in small schools and small towns, and particularly West Wanamaker, or even Wichita, which some folks seem to have forgotten even exists, those folks pay taxes too, property taxes, income taxes, and they are paying for their schools. And the Constitution says that those students will be given an opportunity to be educated just like as if you were from the East. And that's what our Supreme Court stands behind. So it upsets me greatly when that kind of record starts. I remember when I was a young guy, which was a long time ago, that record got pretty staunch in this state, East versus West. And since I've been in the legislature up here, it's in the House and so forth, I didn't run into that much. There were a few legislators who were sort of expanding that, but for the most part, everybody understood how it was and tried to get along. But it really shocks me that this year, that started to raise its ugly head again. And that's not going to be a good situation for anybody in the state, whether you're from the East or from the West. But we have to bear in mind that those folks in those small towns are paying their taxes too. And they probably don't mind paying a bit more taxes if it's necessary to maintain our school systems and to maintain what we have. Again, I'm not really comfortable with these figures. Far better off at 390, 450, or whatever. But you guys know this is what we have before us, and so we're going to have to vote on this. But I felt necessary that I say what I said. And far as saying what I'm going to vote for in the next few minutes, I guess I'm still at a loss. But with that, Mr. President, thank you so much.
Senator from Lane, Senator Tyson.
Would anybody else like me to end the hour late, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Vice President? But I'd like to comment on a couple of items that were said. First off, the Senator commented that this bill stops the hemorrhaging. Hemorrhaging equals a loss of assets in large amounts. Well, I would argue that this bill starts the hemorrhaging. Hemorrhaging of a Kansas taxpayer's income. $600 million tax increase in 1 year for approximately 2.9 million Kansans. So roughly $200 for every Kansan. Another comment was made on $8,000 an acre. Well, I know we would sure like to see that dollar amount where I live. I know that's not what the average farmlanders were in Kansas. I didn't want anybody to have that impression. I would like to thank the Senator from Douglas for his comments. The Conference Committee has been here since 9 a.m. this morning. I know other individuals didn't come in until 2 p.m. We were here late last night, and again this morning.
continue the discussion, which is good. We need to do the business of Kansas. You know, we would agree, I would agree, that it has been a turbulent ride, a very turbulent ride. But we need an exit strategy for that ride. I don't want to jump off on the plane when it's in the air. We need to figure out a landing. I'll read you a couple of headlines. Deadbeat state gets deadbeater. You might think that would apply to Kansas. It's not. Illinois. Another headline. Revenue for the state falls 13% below projection. Oklahoma. Rhode Island faces tougher budget math after a $100 million miss on tax revenue. Behind closed doors, legislative leaders hammer out a state budget. You know, Kansas is a great state, and Kansans believe so, and they are anxious for us to move forward, as are most of us. But I will leave you with one quote, and you may have heard it before, but I think it fits. I contend that for a nation to try to tax itself into prosperity is like a man standing in a bucket trying to lift himself up by the hand. Winston Churchill. With that, I close.
We will hold for final action. We are now ready for final action. On this roll call, we will take the following. The Conference Committee report on Senate Bill 30. The clerk will read the title.
Seeing
none, close roll, tally the vote. 26 voting in favor, 14 against on Senate Bill 30. This measure, having received the required constitutional majority, is hereby declared passed.